wonder, if I were to ask you to name your favorite innovation from any point in human history, what would you say? Whoa, that's a lot of them. Okay, let's have everyone say it together. So I'm gonna count to three, and then I want you guys to yell out your favorite innovation. You can name multiple ones if there's a tiebreaker. So are you guys ready? Okay, one, two, three. Internet. Woo! All right. That's a lot of innovation. I mean, I heard music. I think I heard TEDx, microwave, the internet. There's so much innovation throughout the course of human history. And if you think about it, innovation comes in more forms than just science and technology. It also comes in the form of culture, in government, philosophy. And it may seem obvious, but I find it quite amazing that all of these innovations are made possible because of the human brain. But what is the brain? Well, we know that it's made of about 80 billion neurons, which is a number that's very hard for me to wrap my mind around. So I like to put it in the context of cities. You may recognize this city. It's Amsterdam. It's a city that I'm quite fond of, that I'm also standing in. So if every neuron in your brain were a person, your one brain could populate Amsterdam 100,000 times. And that's just the neurons. It doesn't even include any of the other cell types that are in your head. And these neurons form an extremely complex network. Their cells are joined together through junctions that we know as synapses. So one cell will make a synapse with another cell, and it will communicate with that cell through electrical and chemical impulses. Now, to wrap your mind around the number of synapses that are in your head, it's useful to take an even farther step back, all the way to the Milky Way. So this is the galaxy that we call home. Earth is in it. Our sun is in it. Our sun is one of 300 billion stars in the Milky Way. Now, there are more synapses in one cubic centimeter of your brain than there are stars in the entire Milky Way. And you have about 1,200 cubic centimeters in your brain. It's pretty complex. And the reason that we're interested in studying these synapses and understanding what's going on in the brain is that in order to understand how our brains make us who we are, we need to map the networks of cells that are in the brain, and we need to integrate functional activity maps into those networks. So I work at Sebastian Seung's Computational Neuroscience Lab at MIT. And we are specifically focused on reconstructing synaptic-level neural networks in the brain. So this is one individual synapse. The way that we actually discover these synapses is by taking a volume of brain, and then we image all the way through it. This allows us to see the individual neuron branches that have grown through that volume of brain, so we can reconstruct the branches in full 3D, and we can fit the branches together into entire cells. Then we fit those cells together into networks. And this allows us to understand the cellular level circuitry that's responsible for information processing in the brain. Now, up until a couple years ago, it took thousands of hours to reconstruct one neuron. Now, being a computational neuroscience lab, the amazing team created some software that brought that reconstruction time down to about 50 hours per cell, which is a huge improvement over thousands. But, you know, 50 hours per cell, 80 billion cells in the brain. We calculated, actually, how long that would be. And so, because we're MIT, right? So if you had a team of 100 people, and they were working 24/7 with today's technology, it would take about 500,000 years to map one brain. Right? Humans, Homo sapiens, didn't even exist 500,000 years ago. We were like Homo heidelbergensis, and we were just figuring out how to make spears. So no, we had to really think differently. You know, if we want to answer fundamental questions about the brain, about how this amazing organ results in an individual, in all these individuals, in people who can think and feel and learn and laugh and love. We really have to think outside the box. And so when looking for inspiration, we turned to these guys. Angry Birds, right? Viral online games. People spend about 3 billion hours every week playing online games. And so we thought, well, hey, what if we could turn our lab software into a game and make it so that anyone, anywhere could play? So that's exactly what we did. We created EyeWire. It's a game to map the brain. It's a relatively new project, and it can be played by anyone, anywhere with an internet connection. And while we haven't even been live for a full year, so far over 90,000 people from 130 countries have signed up. And most of them have no neuroscience background. Our community ranges from high school students to dentists, sculptors, and stock traders, and retired people. Now, I know you guys are your TEDsters, and you like to see ideas, so rather than just tell you about the game, I would like to actually show you. So, oh yeah. So, all right, oh my gosh. So, this is EyeWire. I'm going to say, oh, they're already chatting. Hi, guys. From TEDx Amsterdam. Live. So this has actually been running for the whole session. So there's a lot of chat. So there's 50 people who are online actually right now. And they're saying hello. So yeah, Rinda. Hey, Rinda. Ashmore. Ashley is a 21-year-old history major in Belgium. And she is our top scoring player of all time. We spend a lot of time interacting with the players in chat. This thing that you see rotating in the background is actually a neuron. It's one of many cells that have been reconstructed by our players. So I can sort of zoom in and show you some of the branches. We're on Wi-Fi, so I'm not going to actually play the game, but this will give you guys incentive to actually sign up and join to be a part of our lab. Oh, Inkim. Oh, there's a bot in the game. If any of the players are watching the live stream, please invoke the bot. So anyway, we told them that we're going to be at TEDx Amsterdam. And Inkim is a player actually in Germany who's built, he's been hacking on the actual game and has built features and lots of other additional tools. In the actual game, players are challenged to start with one branch of a neuron and extend it to the other side of a cube. And this is sort of the unit of gameplay. And in order to kind of make this fun and keep it fresh, make it so that we can theoretically eventually compete with games like World of Warcraft or really Angry Birds, we have competitions. So we've done, think Facebook versus Twitter in an internet death match. And the winning team who maps the most amount of neurons actually gets to name an individual cell. Yeah, so we have a neuron named Zoidberg. We have some other ones. I don't know what Führer do. Oh, for science. It's in German. Okay, so I don't have a whole lot of time, so I'm going to actually switch back to the rest of my presentation and invite you guys to join EyeWire, of course, and continue to interact with our players, who I think are very awesome. So if we could go back to the other presentation. I could tell you a little bit more about EyeWire in the meantime, if you like. Okay, here we go. Yeah, and so EyeWire is actually the first of what will be many games that will open up the opportunity to take a front row seat in making new discoveries about the brain to anyone with an internet connection. And these are some of the neurons that our players have discovered. It's amazing. If you think about when we live in history, I mean, we're in the midst of unprecedented call for collaboration from European brain projects to the US Brain Initiative and China's vast investment in biological and computer sciences. And in order to achieve the revolutions that we need in neuroscience, in order to really understand how we are, who we are, we need an influx of statisticians, mathematicians, we need designers, and we need hackers to come into the field of neuroscience and really disrupt the way that we're approaching science. And we need young people who have a curiosity about the brain to pursue fields in neuroscience. I think it is an extraordinary time, and that people in 200, 500, 1,000 years, future humans, will look back on today's generation, and they'll say, those ones, those people, were the ones who really laid the foundation for our understanding of the human brain. Thank you.